Lord, we praise God for the opportunity yet again to bring to you Light of Light broadcast. We believe today you will be blessed. Just sit back and get your pen and paper if you can, or open your heart, your Bible, and let us get into the Word of God. May this challenge you, may this expand you, may this increase you, may this stretch you, may this be a blessing to you. To some of you, it's gonna be such a word that will turn around your life. And we believe Life Church International and our broadcast media ministry, which is we call Light of Life broadcast, is gonna be a blessing. An apostle had to have the spiritual gift of apostleship. And this gift was provided by Jesus Christ. And we have read that in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8, all the way to 11, which says, therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Now this, he ascended, what does it mean? But that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth. He who descended is also the one who ascended far above the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he himself gave some to be apostles and prophets, evangelists, pastors and teachers. So the apostle received his gift and office by the sovereign decision of God the Father. It's God who determines what he wants to give you. Tell your neighbor, it's God who determines what he wants to give you. You can't apply to be an apostle. You can't apply to be a pastor. You can't apply to be a singer. You just discover you have a singing gift and ministry. Praise God. But we congratulate those who sing without a gift. We congratulate you. You are doing well. You have stepped out by faith. 1 Corinthians 1:1 says, Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God. It's through the will of God. Everybody says through the will of God. Whatever you receive, whatever gift it is through the will of God. For Paul, it was through the will of God. For instance, in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 18, write down, 1 Corinthians 12, verse 18, the Bible says, but now God has set the members, each one of them in the body, just as he pleased. Just as he pleased. He has placed you in the body as he pleases. Everybody say, as God pleases, he puts me where I belong. In Ephesians 1, verse 11, Ephesians 1, verse 11. No, 1:1. I, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in God. By the will of God. An apostle by what? By the will of God. Place there, your gift right there. I, so-and-so, a singer, by the will of God. I, an administrator, administrating the things of God, by the will of God. I, a deacon in the house of God, to serve others. I love it. It's easy for me to just serve others in hospitality, by the will of God. Colossians 1:1. Paul says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 1. Write down. He says, am I not an apostle? Am I not free? Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Are you not my work in the Lord? If I am not an apostle to others, yet doubtless I am to you. For you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. That's politics. But it's good politics, Paul is saying right now. I mean right there. Because I was Apollos. And these Corinthians were getting confused. Every time they saw a powerful man of God, they ran after him and they forgot the other old one. Every time another man of God came into town, they abandoned that and went to another one. Every time a new thing happens in the city, they move to that direction and forget the other one. So Paul says, let's make things clear. Am I not an apostle? And then he says, doesn't an apostle have a people that are an evidence of his apostleship? What are the credentials of an apostle? Or things that mark him out? But generally, number one, an apostle was endowed with miraculous powers of miracles. Power. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 4. Hebrews 2, 4. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him? Verse 4. Hebrews 2. God also bearing witness both with signs and wonders, with various miracles, gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to his own will. Preaching the gospel, accompanied with signs and wonders. 2 Corinthians 12, 12. I'm writing down these things. Because listen, when God teaches you these things, the purpose is that you can have a personal revelation about this thing. Let it settle in your spirit. The other day, Pastor Sunda taught us very powerfully the need to move on to maturity, move on to the other dimensions. And then I taught about how signs and wonders and the demonstration of the Spirit comes in to help us have our faith established in God and not man. And then after that, as we progress to maturity, we also need to learn the wisdom of God. The Bible said to the mature, we don't just manifest signs and wonders, but also the wisdom of God. So apostles should operate both in signs and wonders and also in the depths of the mysteries, releasing the wisdom of God. 2 Corinthians 12, 12, the scripture says, truly the signs of an apostle were accomplished among you with all perseverance in signs and wonders and mighty deeds. Secondly, an apostle in the scriptures had success and ought to have success in evangelism, preaching the gospel. First Corinthians 9, verse 2. We just read it. Am I not an apostle to others? Yet doubtless I am to you, for you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. You are the seal. You, Corinthians, you are physical, breathing people. Samples, evidence of the gospel that was preached. It has affected you, changed you. Listen, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1 to 3. Because this is an issue of fruit right here. And the same wisdom you apply in areas of your gift. Do you have fruit in what you do? Do you have result in what you do? 2 Corinthians 3, verse 1 to 3. Do we begin again to commend ourselves? Paul asks. Or do we need, as some others, epistles of commendation to you or letters of commendation from you? You are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read by all men. Clearly, you are an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is, of the heart. In other words, you Corinthians, you are the evidence of our ministry. Listen, changed lives is one of the evidences of apostolic ministry. Lives have been changed, and here they are. Galatians 2, verse 7 to 9. Hear this. But on the contrary, when they saw that the gospel for the uncircumcised, or Gentiles, had been committed to me, this is Paul writing, as the gospel for the circumcised, the Jews, was to Peter, for he who worked effectively in Peter for the apostleship to the circumcised, also worked effectively in me towards the Gentiles. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that had been given to me, they gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship, that we should go to the Gentiles, and they go to the circumcised. Apostles are given by God a specific jurisdiction, a specific people, a specific entry point. To Peter, this way, to Paul, that way. So that there is no competition, there's no push and pull, there's no strife. Everyone has his own place in the Spirit. And I say to you, you have your place in the Spirit. Did you hear that?
And what God has given you, no one can remove it from you. That's why, let me tell you, that's why I trust God in my own testimony that I can remain secure in Christ. And I think I'm secure. Nobody who intimidates me. Everybody has his own ministry. Everybody has his own calling. Do what God has given you. Do the best you can. If I can assist you, that's great. I will assist you. I am not intimidated by success of anyone because everyone has his own area of operation. Be secure as a man. Be secure as a minister. Be secure as a believer. No one should ever threaten you. Be happy to do what you are doing. And you discover we need each other. Hello? And insecure leaders cause a lot of trouble in the body of Christ. They come up with mikakati. Laws, do's and don'ts in the church because they think if they place these rules and don'ts, it will maintain and keep the people here. Let me tell you, I don't keep you here. It is God who called you here and it is God who will keep you here. Mine is to minister to you and love you the best I can do. Be secure. An apostle had the capacity to suffer patiently. To suffer what? Let me tell you, some callings attract more troubles than other callings. Unfortunately, you are not given the opportunity to choose the best. God chooses for you. Some callings have what? This 2 Corinthians 12:12 we read, that truly the signs of an apostle were accomplished among you. But listen how they were, with all perseverance. Someone say, with all perseverance. You need to persevere in your gift and calling because anytime you say, yes, Lord, use me, send me, I will serve you, I will work for you. Aha. Some troubles trace your address. Are you listening? They trace your address. What do you do? Persevere. So when you receive a calling from God, in the package of that thing, has some levels of suffering. Tell your neighbor, suffer patiently. Persevere. I sense an anointing right there, right now. I sense the power of God. May you receive encouragement from God in the name of Jesus. Whatever that you're going through that has been difficult, I tell you, may you receive the grace to go through it. It may be very simple. You get a simple job, then all of a sudden your colleagues at work, they begin to squeeze and push you and so forth, and politics and so forth, and harassment and so forth. It has attracted some devils, new levels, new devils, they say it. That's Shakespeare type of talk. But I think it's also true. I mean, but even then, may you have the grace to stand. And having done all, stand again. Stand therefore, putting on the whole arm of God that you can go through. Tell your neighbor you will go through even this time. What are the functions of an apostle? One, to receive revelation and communication from God. To receive revelation and communication from God. We quoted Ephesians chapter 3, verse 2 to 6. I'm going to read it and listen to this. I hope you're writing down. Ephesians 3, verse 2 to 6. How by revelation he made known to me the mystery, as I have briefly written already, by which when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit. No. Verse 5. Mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to his holy apostles and prophets. Listen to that. That the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ through the gospel. Paul got this revelation about the non-Jews, the Gentiles, how they were to be part of the salvation plan. It had not been revealed before. Praise God. I still believe even today, God is revealing dimension. Listen, like this revelation of the transfer of wealth is a revelation revealed to the holy apostles and prophets. And the church is walking into that. The revelation of spiritual warfare has come into the church from the 80s and the 90s when they began to deal with the 10-40 window, praying that these nations may be open. It was a revelation that was poured out, and people began to teach and minister about it and established institutions of prayer and intercession that has moved to this day when almost every country has a prayer, house of prayer. Up to date, and every church has intercessors. It was not there before. It's a revelation that was brought in through the apostles and prophets. And the body of Christ is beginning to function into that. Let me tell you something. There is still more that God has that he wants to do in these last days. And it's going to be revealed. Secondly, apostles not only receive that revelation, but they also communicate the gospel effectively. And people accept Christ in response to the preaching. I don't know any apostle who is not a good preacher, preaching the gospel effectively. Apostles helped organize local churches and appointed leaders or officers of local churches. They did what? Helped organize the churches and appointed officers in the local church. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 14, verse 23. Listen to the scripture. Acts 14:23. So when they had appointed elders in every church and prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord in whom they had believed. The apostles were involved in the operation of bringing elders and pastors and other leaders into the church and appoint them through the process of seeking the Lord in prayer and fasting to find the mind of God to bring leaders into ministry. Let me tell you, that grace and anointing to bring leaders into ministry is not a function of everyone. It's an apostolic function. Listen to Titus chapter 1, verse 5. For this reason, Titus 1, 5. For this reason, I left you in Crete, that you should set in order the things that are lacking and appoint elders in every city as I commanded you. Paul appoints Titus, sends him to a city called Crete to go and do what? Appoint leaders. It's different from, I have an invitation to go for a mission, so I've gone. This one is, you are sent, apostoled. Everybody say sent. The power manifestation and authority in the spirit when you are sent is different from when you just showed up and went because you have a letter through the P.O. box. Did you hear what I just said? Yes. Yeah. Another dimension, apostles trained new believers in doctrine. First Thessalonians 1, 5 and First Thessalonians 2, 12. Let's read those scriptures. Paul says, for our gospel did not come unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. In chapter 2 of the same 1 Thessalonians, verse 12, that you would walk worthy of God who hath called you unto his kingdom and glory. Continue to walk in this thing that we introduced to you in power. Did you hear what I just said? Continue to walk in this thing that we introduced to you and taught you as a function, as an apostolic function, to train believers in the doctrine. Something else, apostles had the authority and still do to administer discipline to believers. And let me tell you, this nation has stepped into a place where believers are not ready for discipline. Because churches are many now. You can just go next door. It's foolishness in the body of Christ. Church discipline must be done. And if your discipline don't make noise,
Most people, you discipline them, they attack the leader. You throw a finger to a leader because he's disciplined you, you will go into spiritual jail for 7 years. There must be correction in the body of Christ. You must be told, no, it's wrong. And there are several things in scripture that shows what can bring one into discipline. And one of them basically is gossip. Gossip and dividing believers and dividing the people and talking too much. You will be told to shut up and your mouth will be shut. Zip. So that the rest of the church can be calm and continue in peace.
Tell your neighbor, take care of your mouth. Otherwise, you will come under apostolic discipline. Read these scriptures with me, two of them, and you tell me whether Paul was disciplining them or he was soothing them. First Timothy chapter 1, verse 20. Hear what Paul said. Paul was dangerous, like David Juma, praise God. First Timothy chapter 1, verse 20.
Of whom are Hymenaeus, whatever is the pronunciation, and Alexander, whom I delivered to Satan that they may learn not to blaspheme.
Huh? You can be put in a box and delivered to another site.
Read 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 21.
1 Corinthians 4, 21. You tell me whether this is not discipline. I like what Paul is saying. Are you there?
What do you want? Shall I come to you with a rod or in love and a spirit of gentleness? Jibu Yoswali.
What do you want? Ask your neighbor, what do you want? When you hear the pastors began to ask, what is wrong with you? What do you want? Shall I come to you with a rod or in love and a spirit of gentleness? There are issues to deal with. Hello?
Let's read one more scripture. One more scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 13.
2 Corinthians 13, verse 2.
The Bible says, I have told you before, and foretell as I were present the second time, and now being absent, I write to those who have sinned before, and to all the rest. And if I come again, I will not spare.
One of the greatest challenges in the church is pastors who spare. I used to spare myself, but I moved away from sparing. And when it's bleeding you, there's nowhere you're going. You can't change church. But anyway, if you want to go rebelliously, you go. What will have happened is that you'll have failed the class. That unit, you failed.
Father, we give you praise. Thank you, our God. And now, if you're not born again, why don't you pray with me? Say, dear Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died and rose again. I believe you need me. And now I come with all my heart. Forgive me and wash me with your precious blood. And let me never be the same again. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I tell you, the gospel is amazing. The word of God is amazing. It doesn't matter how, you take it. But if you take it rightly and with the right attitude, it will change your life. And I believe something good has happened to you. And so may God bless you and keep you. We're going to see you next time. Stay tuned in. And hey, let us know that it is changing your life, it's blessing your life. Write us an email, write us a text or a letter or on Facebook or whatever. Go to our website, Life Church Kenya, and let us know that you're being affected greatly by this message for the glory of God. In Jesus' name, we bless you.